Good afternoon. Today we will see what are protective devices. So here so this is just a slide showing you the various types of protective devices. Now let us come to the definition of protective devices. A device used to protect equipment, machinery, components and devices in electrical and electronic circuit against short circuit, overcurrents and earth faults is called as protective devices. So how do we define that? A device used to protect equipment, machinery, components and devices in electrical and electronic circuits against short circuit, overcurrents and earth faults is called as protective devices. Now why do we need these protective devices? So whenever we are conducting an experiment, say some kind of fault occurs in the circuit, then if there is a protective device in the circuit, that will be the first one to blow out, thereby it will protect the remaining circuit from damage. It will isolate the faulty section from the functioning section of the circuit and thereby protect the other devices present in the circuit. Now let us see what is the necessity of protective devices. Protective devices are necessary to protect electrical appliance or equipments against short circuits, abnormal variation in the supply voltage, overloading of the equipment, and also to protect the operator against accidental contact with the faulty equipment, failing which the operator may get a severe shock. So these are the reasons why we need protective devices. So we have to protect our circuit against short circuits, abnormal variations in the supply voltage. Many a times you would have observed voltage fluctuations or overloading of the equipment. The equipment may draw excessive current, and also to protect the operator against accidental contact with any faulty equipment, so you can prevent him from getting shock. Now what are the types of protective devices? There are different types of protective devices which are commonly used, namely fuse wire or fuse. This is the simplest of the protective devices which most of us are familiar with, which we have seen in our day-to-day lives. Next is the MCB. MCB stands for miniature circuit breaker. This also you would have observed in your homes where it is fitted almost near the meter board. You could have observed that. Then the third is ELCB. ELCB stands for earth leakage circuit breaker. And fourth type is a combination of ELCB and MCB. So both together, the combination of both is ELCB and MCB. And next we require earthing and or grounding. Now let us start with fuse, the simplest protective device. Now what is a fuse? Now fuse, generally we refer to it as the fuse wire or the fuse link. So fuse generally means a fuse wire which is placed in a fuse holder. It is a safety device which protects electrical and electronic circuits against overloads, short circuits and earth faults. So you can observe here the picture of a fuse. This is the simplest fuse which all of us are very familiar and we have seen it. And this is the symbol for a fuse. This shape what you see is the symbol for a fuse. Now the fuse wire or the fuse link is made up of low resistivity material and also has low melting point. So in case of any fault in the circuit, the fuse wire or the fuse link, because it has got a low melting point, it melts and it separates the healthy section of the circuit from the faulty section and thereby protects the circuit elements. Now examples like of fuse wire or link, it is made up of alloys of low melting point metals like lead, tin, copper, cadmium, bismuth, silver, zinc, etc. So these are some of the alloys which have got low melting point and they are used in the manufacturing of fuse wire. Now let us understand how a fuse operates. So we understood what are protective devices, why we need protective devices, types of protective devices. In that, the simplest one is the fuse, and now we are going to understand how the fuse operates. Fuse is a short length of wire. It is a simple wire. It is a short length of wire designed to melt and separate in case of excessive current. The fuse is always connected in the phase of the supply. It is always connected in series with the circuit or the components that need to be protected. So this is the main things we have to understand. It is always in the phase line of the supply. It is connected in series with the circuit or component that needs to be protected. When the current drawn by the circuit exceeds the rated current of the fuse wire, the fuse wire melts and breaks. This disconnects the supply from the circuit and thus protects the circuit and the components present in the circuit. Now let us watch one simple video of how So here is a simple video. Let's watch the video again. You can observe this simple video here, how a fuse works.
By heat or fire. If a motor draws too much current too quickly, the fuse will blow. A fuse is a thin metal wire that protects a device from too much current. Here's how it works. When electrons flow through a circuit, they create heat in the metal wires. The thinner the wire, the harder it is for the electrons to move, so more heat is generated. When there's too much current, the fuse acts like a weakest link in a chain by heating up more quickly than the other components, and it melts. That That breaks the current flow and protects the more expensive components from damage by heat or fire. If a motor draws too much current too quickly, the fuse will blow.
You saw a small video, a short video, where you observe the fuse wire. When there was excessive current drawn by the circuit, you saw how the fuse wire snapped or it broke off. It melts. So thereby what happens, there will be an open circuit in the circuit, and thereby there will be no continuity for the flow of current, and thus protects the other circuit elements present in the circuit. Next, we will see what are the symbol of fuse. So, these are some of the various symbols which are used to represent a fuse. You can just observe the symbols here. So, these are different ways of representing a fuse. And you can observe in this circuit, it is a simple circuit with EMF source, then we have a fuse and then a resistor, that is a load. So, this is the simplest circuit. So, in case of any fault, the fuse wire snaps, thereby creating an open circuit and protects the load section. Now, we have to understand what is the rating of a fuse wire. The maximum current that a fuse can carry without being burnt is called as the rating of the fuse wire. So, it is the maximum current that it can withstand without being burnt, that is called as the rating of the fuse wire. It is expressed in amperes. For example, we can have a 5 ampere fuse. Means what? If the current rating exceeds 5 amps, goes beyond 5 amps, say like 7 amps, 8 amps or 10 amps, it goes beyond the rating, then the fuse is going to snap. It can withstand up to 5 amps. We have 10 amps fuse, 16 amps, 60 amps, 100 amps, etc. Current rating of the fuse selected for the circuit should be equal to the maximum current rating of the machinery or the appliance or the component connected in the circuit. So, how do we have to choose the fuse wire for any circuit? The current rating of the fuse selected should be equal to maximum current rating of the machinery. Suppose we have a machinery whose maximum current rating is 15 amps, maximum current rating is 60 amps, let us say for example, then you have to use a fuse wire which can withstand up to that. Now, there are different types of fuses. Here you can observe, like for low voltage applications, mainly three types of fuses are going to be used, namely rewireable fuse, cartridge fuse and HRC fuse. HRC stands for high rupturing capacity fuse. So, there are three types: rewireable fuse, cartridge fuse and HRC fuse. Here you can see some pictures of rewireable fuses. You can observe here the fuse holder and the fuse channel. This is the fuse wire and this is the different cross section of the fuse that has been shown. These are the different sizes of the fuses. This again is a fuse holder. Now, why it is called as rewireable fuse? Because in case the fuse blows out, you can replace the fuse wire and it can be reused. That is why it is called as rewireable fuses. So, as the name indicates, it is a fuse unit in which only the fuse wire is replaced by a new one whenever the fuse is blown off. The entire fuse unit is not scrapped as in the case of other fuses. So, only the wire, if it blows out, just to replace the wire. The rest of the units, that is the ceramic body, that is the fuse holder or the fuse channel, need not be replaced. Let us see the construction of rewireable fuse. Now, every rewireable fuse unit has the following parts. One is the fuse wire, fuse carrier, fuse channel or the fuse holder. So, it has a fuse wire, fuse carrier, fuse channel or the fuse holder. Now, what is this fuse wire made up of? The material used for the construction of fuse wire is lead and tin alloy for low currents up to 15 amps. So, an alloy is used of lead and tin for currents up to 15 amps. For currents higher than that, up to 60 amps, copper and tin alloy are used. A fuse wire made up of copper and tin alloy is going to be used. Tinned copper is also going to be used for currents above 60 amperes and up to 100 amperes. The fuse wire is manufactured in standard ratings of 5 amps, 10 amps, 15 amps, 30, 60 and 100 amperes. Next, we have to understand the fuse carrier and the fuse channel. The fuse carrier and the fuse channel, you can see below this the fuse wire is going to be present. So, this is the fuse carrier and this is the fuse channel. They are made up of porcelain or bakelite material, because we know porcelain and bakelite are both insulating materials. So, whenever we have to handle the fuse, naturally we have to have a insulating material so that it prevents us from getting any shock. So, it is made up of porcelain or bakelite material. They are used for all domestic, commercial and industrial applications up to 100 amps capacity. So, this type of fuse is going to be used for a rating of up to 100 amperes capacity. Next, we will move on to the second type of fuse. So, first we studied about rewireable fuse and the parts of the rewireable fuse we saw. Now, we will move on to cartridge fuse. Now, this cartridge fuse, it is made up of a form of a cartridge. It looks like a bullet like. Now, this is normally manufactured in the range of 2 amperes to 100 amperes. And whenever the fuse blows out, the fuse with carrier is replaced by a new one. So, whereas in rewireable, we had to replace only the fuse wire. Whereas in cartridge fuse, the entire carrier along with the fuse wire has to be replaced. As it is a sealed one, it cannot be rewired. It is a sealed fuse, so you cannot do rewiring. So, here you can see some pictures of a cartridge fuse. So, usually a glass tube or a ceramic tube is present and inside that the fuse wire or the fuse link will be present. At the ends, you can see the end caps are metal caps. You can observe here, they are metal caps which is used to hold the fuse wire in place. Now, cartridge fuses are used to protect motors and branch circuits where higher amps or voltage ratings are required. They are available in a wide variety of sizes, ampere and voltage ratings up to around 600 volts AC and 600 amps. These are extensively used in commercial, industrial and agricultural applications, as well as residential fuse panels, air conditioning, pumps, appliances, etc. The cartridge fuses are available in two types. One is the general purpose fuse, which have no time delay and protect fuse panels, appliances and branch circuits. Other one is the heavy duty fuses, which have a time delay feature. So here you can observe some cartridge fuses. You can just observe here, this is the ferrule type of cartridge fuse. So the ends have a metal cap, and inside you can observe there is a wire there. Okay, so this is a glass tube. So here you can see a section is shown, inside there is a wire, the end caps. So this is another type, screw type of cartridge fuse. This is the tube type, this is the screw type. And this picture just shows you how this cartridge fuse is used in a plug. You can observe here the neutral, this is the neutral wire, this is the earth wire, this is the line, and here we are using the fuse. So the fuse is always connected along with the line, in series with the line, in the phase line of the supply. Next, coming to the construction of cartridge fuse, it is the fuse, again any fuse, it has got the same parts like the fuse wire, the fuse carrier and the fuse channel or the fuse holder. The fuse wire here is either a round or a flat strip. The material used for the construction of the strip is silver and silver alloys for currents up to 15 amps. And for higher current ratings, copper and copper alloys are going to be used. So here the fuse wire is round or a flat strip. So the material used for the construction of the fuse wire or the fuse link is depends upon the current rating required. For low currents up to 15 amps, silver and silver alloys are used. And for higher ratings up to 100 amps, copper and copper alloys are going to be used. The cartridge, next, the next part of the cartridge fuse is the cartridge. Now this is a glass or a ceramic tube with metal caps fixed at both the ends for fuse contacts. Inside it is filled with quartz sand or an inert gas to quench the arc. Sometimes what happens, an arcing takes place inside the fuse. Whenever there is a break in the circuit, an arc, there is a possibility of an occurrence of an arc. So that arc has to be quenched. Quenched means it has to be subsided, it has to be put off. In order to put off that, inside the tube, quartz sand or some inert gas is going to be present. The fuse holder is made up of bakelite or PVC. So here it, you can see it is either a screw type or channel type. So this is a cartridge fuse. You can observe here this flat plate, you can see that constitutes the fuse wire which is inside this tube. And here you can observe the cartridge fuse has been placed inside the fuse holder. And this is another section of the fuse carrier which is shown here. Next we move on to the HRC fuse. HRC fuse, it stands for high rupture capacity fuse. It is normally designed for high currents up to of about 1250 amperes. When the fuse is blown off, the entire unit has to be replaced by a new one. It cannot be rewired as it is a sealed one. So now we understand here. In the rewireable one, we were able to just replace the fuse wire. Whereas in HRC fuse, in case the fuse is going to blow off, either due to short circuit or over current faults or the earth faults, then the entire unit has to be replaced. And here you can observe some some of the HRC fuse. Now, this is the internal architecture of an HRC fuse. So, this is the end metal cap, this is the porcelain body, and inside you can observe here, this is the tin alloy strip. It is a strip of tin alloy which constitutes the fuse wire, and surrounding the fuse wire is the silica sand, that is the quartz sand or the silica sand, which is used to quench the arc. So, this is another representation of the same thing, and this is how it appears, the HRC fuse. Coming to the construction of the HRC fuse, again the same parts, the fuse wire, the fuse carrier, the fuse channel or the fuse holder. The fuse wire here is either a round or a flat strip, which is made up of copper alloy or lead and tin alloy. Now, it is made up of silver and silver alloy for low currents and copper alloys for high currents. The fuse carrier is made up of a ceramic tube of either circular or rectangular in cross section. It is fixed with flat metal strips on both sides for external connection, and it is filled with quartz sand or marble dust or some inert gas to quench the cool and quench the arc. So, just now we studied the different types of commonly used fuses. Now, we will move on to what is the characteristics that is to be possessed by a good fuse. A good fuse wire should possess the following characteristics. 1. It should have low resistivity, it should have low melting point, and it should have low conductivity of metal vapors formed when the fuse is blown off. Next, we will see what are the advantages of HRC fuse. HRC fuse, they require no maintenance. It is a completely sealed fuse, so no maintenance. They are highly reliable and they operate at high speed, and they have a consistent performance. Consistent performance, that is, you can highly rely this HRC fuse, and for a particular rating it has got a consistent performance, not much variations in its performance. They clear both low and high fault currents with equal efficiency. So, these are some of the advantages of HRC fuse. Next, we will move on to the topic of miniature circuit breaker. In short, we call it as MCB. So, here you can see some pictures of MCB. Very commonly you might have observed it near in your houses, near the energy meter board, you might have observed it. Now, what is this miniature circuit breaker, that is an MCB? Now, this is a safety device which works on magnetothermic release principle. It is connected in phase between the supply and the load. So, the first principle of a fuse is it is between the supply and the load. It is manufactured in standard ratings of 6 amperes to 40 amperes. We can see it near the meter board of every house, whether it is, you can observe that. Now, when the current drawn by the load exceeds the rated value, it acts and trips the circuit, thus protecting the apparatus, operator and the appliance. So, all of us, we might have observed in our homes, suddenly the MCB trips due to some overload or overvoltage fluctuations. So, it trips whenever there is an excess current. Now, this is the internal architecture of the miniature circuit breaker. can observe there is a solenoid here. So it works on the magnetothermic principle. Now, application of MCBs, where do we use it? So it is used in all modern homes, offices, factories, power plants, industries to protect motors, mixers, grinders, heaters, lathe machines, circuits, etc., etc. Now, what are the advantages of using this MCB? Now, they act and open the circuit in less than 5 milliseconds. So, within a 5 milliseconds, in case a fault has occurred, immediately it trips. Automatic switch off under overload and short circuit condition. So, any excessive current or in case of a short circuit. Short circuit, usually when the two opposite terminals are going to touch, there is going to be a condition of short circuit. Okay. Now, no fuse to replace or rewire. So, it is a completely sealed one, nothing to replace, thereby it requires no repairs. Supply is restored by resetting it again. Next, we move on to the next type of circuit breaker, that is the ELCB. It stands for Earth Leakage Circuit Breaker. Now, this is again a domestic safety device which trips the circuit when there is small leakage to earth or body of the appliance. So, if there is leakage in any of the electrical appliances that we are using at home, it may be a mixer, grinder, iron box or a geyser, anything. So, if there is a leakage from to the earth from the body of the appliance, thus it protects the operator from shocks and accidents. This is connected in the circuit of the appliance that is to be protected. So, it is connected in circuit of the appliance to be protected. This is the simple circuit of a ELCB. So, here you can see this is line, neutral, this is the trip coil. So, this acts as the circuit here, this is the test resistor and this here is the load. Now, what are the types of ELCB? So, usually two types are there. One is the voltage ELCB, another is the current ELCB. Now, these days, a combination of both MCB and ELCB is available. So, this is a combination of both MCB and ELCB. It acts as one single unit. It acts on both the occasions of earth leakage and overload and protects the circuit. So, even in case there is excess current drawn by the appliance, that is overloading, or there is any leakage in the appliance, in both the cases it is going to work, because this is a combination of MCB and ELCB, and thereby it trips in case of any fault and it protects the operator as well as the appliance. So, this is another simple picture of MCB and ELCB unit. You can observe here it is a combination of ELCB and MCB, and here again it is a combination of ELCB and MCB. Next, we move on to flame proof enclosures used in switch gears. So, now we have to understand what is this switch gears. Now, switch gears are equipments which are used to make and break the high voltage and high current circuits. So, whenever you want to make or break the circuit, in case of high voltage, high current, we are going to make use of switch gears. When they make or break the circuit, sparking takes place and in turn sometimes flame may occur. So, because of the heavy arcing or sparking that is going to take place, it may catch fire. A fire can take place. Flames can be seen. Hence, flame-proof enclosures. Enclosure is nothing but a box or a covering for the fuse unit that is provided. So, enclosures are provided to the switch gears. These enclosures are made of porcelain or asbestos cement or bakelite, which can withstand high temperatures and flames. So, the material used for the construction of these enclosures is usually all insulating materials, like it can be porcelain or asbestos cement or bakelite. Why these materials are used? Because they can withstand high temperatures and flames. They do not catch fire. So, that is why they are used in the construction of these enclosures. So, here you can observe some flame proof enclosures here. These are some of the, this again you can observe, this is of a transformer, this is a flame proof enclosure. This again is a flame proof enclosures. Next, we have to understand something about earthing and grounding. Now, what do we mean by earthing or grounding? Connecting the metal body of an electrical appliance, machinery, or an electrical installation to earth through a low resistance wire is called as earthing or grounding. So, what do? Any electrical appliance, machinery, or installation. We say installation because you might have observed some huge towers, transmission towers, you might have observed, or a huge transformer, machines, machineries, appliance, whatever. The metal body of these is connected to the earth through a low resistance wire, through a low resistance wire. Now, why do we use a low resistance wire? Because in case any fault occurs or there is excess current that is flows in the circuit, this low resistance wire offers the least resistance path. This low resistance wire offers least resistance path to the current, and thereby all the current is going to be drained to the earth. And we know that earth is at zero potential and it absorbs all the excess charges. Now, this is called as earthing or grounding. Now, we understood what is earthing and grounding. Next, we have to understand what is the necessity of earthing. Earthing is necessary for all domestic, commercial, and industrial installations to safeguard the operator, buildings, and machinery against maybe lightning also, against overloads as well as against lightning. Metal body of all the electrical appliances, equipments, machinery, earth points of a 3-pin socket, you might have observed the 3-pin sockets in at your houses, and the body of the energy meter are all connected to the earth, or it is called, so you tell it as earthed. It is earthed through a thick GI wire. GI means it is galvanized iron wire. So, it is a thick wire. It is a thick low resistance wire. Now, why do we use a thick wire? We have already understood how, what is the equation for resistance. We know the equation for resistance is R equals rho L by A. R equals rho L by A. Now, A stands for cross section of the wire, and resistance is inversely proportional to the cross section of the wire. Thereby, if you increase the cross section, the resistance decreases because it is an inverse proportion. That is why we are going to use a thick wire, and we prefer to use galvanized iron because it is a low resistance material. So how does this earthing happen? Like, whenever a live wire comes in contact with the body of the appliance, it is directly connected to the earth through the grounding wire, and hence the body voltage comes to zero. Now, why do shocks take place? Shock happens because of difference in potential. Now, what we are doing? We are connecting the body, that is the metal part of the appliance, to the earth through this low resistance wire. So, thereby what happens? The metal part or the body of the appliance is going to be at zero potential, which is the earth's potential. Therefore, the operator does not get any shock when he comes in contact with the body of the appliance. And also, the high voltages that are going to be induced during lightning is discharged to the earth through the grounding wire, and thereby you can safeguard the buildings or the machinery. So they are also called as lightning arresters. You might have seen there, where which are erected on top of tall huge buildings, you might have observed. Next, coming to the types of earthing, there are two types of earthing. One is the plate earthing and another is the pipe earthing. So here, this is one type of earthing, which is the plate earthing, where we are going to use a copper plate. You can observe here, this is a copper plate which is going to be embedded deep inside the earth soil, and this is the pit cover, this is the brickwork, or and this is the GI pipe which is connected to the copper plate. So this type of plating earthing is called as plate earthing. Another type is the pipe earthing. So here you can observe, this is a pipe here. Okay, this is a pipe which is embedded through alternate layers of charcoal and salt deep inside the soil. It is going to be embedded, and this is at this funnel is present at the surface or almost at the ground level. Okay, now this is the construction of a pipe earthing. So there are two types of earthing which can be used. One is the plate earthing and another is the pipe earthing. Now, coming to the last aspect of what are the general safety precautions that must be followed. So, till now we studied what are protective devices, what is the necessity of protective devices, what are the different types of protective devices, how the construction is made of the different types, like for example, the rewireable fuse, the cartridge fuse, the HRC fuse, and then we saw the different types of circuit breakers, miniature circuit breaker, MCB, then we saw ELCB, earth leakage circuit breaker, combination of MCB and ELCB. So, we have understood what are protective devices, their construction, and foremost is why, what is the need for using protective devices in a circuit. Now we have to understand what are the general safety precautions one has to take. So you might have observed wherever there are electrical installations, some sign boards are going to be erected. You can observe like this: danger, electrical hazards, high voltage. Then you can see here hazardous voltage. So, you can see some signboards which are put up to protect the public against electrical hazards. Now, what are the safety precautions? Now, there must be at least two people in the laboratory while working on live circuits or chemical processing. Shoes must always be worn at all the times. We must remove any loose conductive jewelry, trinkets, rings, etc., which may come in contact with the exposed circuits. One should not wear loose ties, scarves, or other garments or clothing when working around machines. Unless otherwise stated, we must consider all circuits to be hot and we have to take precaution. When making measurements, we must make it a habit to use only one hand at a time. No part of a live wire should be touched with bare hands. So, never touch a live wire with bare hands. Keep the body or any part of it out of the circuit. Whenever interconnecting wires and cables, they should be arranged so that people will not trip over these wires. So, if a number of wires are to be used for connections, we have to take care of that so that nobody trips over those wires. As far as possible, we have to have a neat workbench area. That is, the place where we are working, the work area must always be kept clean. Any unnecessary material should be removed from the workbench. We must always check to see that the power switch is off before plugging into the outlet. And also, turn instrument or equipment off before unplugging from the outlet. So, whether you want to plug in or remove from the plug, all the time we have to, both the times we have to take care that the power switch is off. When unplugging a power cord, that is the wire has got a head, the plug, one should not tug or pull the plug. You must not pull the cable, you must hold the plug and remove it from the outlet. When disassembling a circuit, first remove the source of power. No ungrounded electrical or electronic apparatus is to be used in the laboratory unless it is double insulated or battery operated. So, all machines, appliances, etc. must be grounded. If it is ungrounded, then you have to take care. Keep fluids, chemicals, heat away from the instruments and the circuits. Report any damages to the equipment or in case of any hazards, sparking, arcing or a slight flame, any potential hazards in the laboratory has to be immediately reported to the lab instructor. If any doubt in electrical safety, you must always talk to the lab instructor. Regarding specific equipment, consult the instruction manual provided by the manufacturer of the equipment. Information regarding safe use and possible hazards should be studied carefully before operating the equipment. Every equipment will be provided with a manual, safety manual provided by the manufacturer. So, whenever we have to operate an equipment, first we should go through the manual. Look out for any specific instructions of how to operate the equipment and then we must carry out the experiments. Now, why do we have to follow all these safety measures? Because work shouldn't be shocking. We must enjoy working through the experiments or the devices or the use of appliance, whether it is in the laboratory, in the domestic life, industrial life, wherever we are going to use, without being shocked. Thank you.